Hello and welcome to the episode 42 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today's highlights include the recording of an album, the first live performance in the United States, and a wedding. On the 11th of February 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, were engaged twice in the same night in Liverpool, at the Latham Hall and at the Casanova Club. The first show was another BK Promotions event. The second engagement, at the renovated and relocated club opened just 2 days earlier, was the first of many negotiated with the local promoter Sam Leach. In 1962, the Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, performed at the Casbah Coffee Club in Liverpool. 1963. The Beatles were in Studio 2 at the EMI Studios in Abbey Road to record their debut LP, Please Please Me. It was not unusual for a band to record an entire LP in one day in the early 1960s. Most of the music was performed live with minimum overdubs, and sometimes quality took second place after budget considerations. The Beatles managed to record 10 excellent tracks today. The LP was rounded up with the 4 previously recorded songs already issued as singles and B-sides. Originally, the band was booked for 2 sessions, one from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and the other from 2:30 to 5:30 p.m. But the second session was completed at 6 p.m. and a third took place from 7:30 to 10:45 p.m., lasting 45 minutes beyond the normal closing time for the studios. John Lennon, suffering from a cold, got through the recordings thanks to tea, milk, cigarettes, and cold pills. The morning session didn't go particularly well, and so, while the rest of the staff went out for lunch, the Beatles remained in the studio to keep playing and refining their material. Richard Langham, tape operator, is quoted in the Complete Beatles Recording Sessions, remembering, "We told them we were having a break, but they said they would like to stay on and rehearse. When we came back, they'd been playing right through. We couldn't believe it. We had never seen a group work right through their lunch break before." The songs recorded today were There's a Place, completed in 10 morning and 3 afternoon takes. I Saw Her Standing There, still called 17 at this point. The song was completed in 9 morning and 3 afternoon takes. A Taste of Honey, 7 takes. Do You Want to Know a Secret, 8 takes. Misery, 11 takes. Hold Me Tight, completed in 13 takes and not issued at the time. It will be re-recorded for the band's second LP, with the Beatles. Anna, Go to Him, completed in 3 takes. Boys, 1 take. Chains, 4 takes. Baby, It's You, 3 takes. And finally, Twist and Shout, 2 takes, contrary to what the legend says. The second take, though, was much inferior to the first, due to Lennon completely losing his voice for his cold and the fatigue of the day of recordings. Some publications, including New Musical Express and Pop Weekly, suggested that the band also recorded Keep Your Hands Off My Baby, but the otherwise extremely detailed EMI recording sheet for the day does not have any mention of this title, according to Beatles historian Mark Lewison. On the 11th of February 1964, the Beatles traveled by train through a snowstorm from New York City to Washington, D.C. There was a special carriage full of members of the press that traveled with the band, and, at the arrival, 2,000 fans surrounded the train, clamoring for the Beatles. The Fabs gave a press conference and then visited WWDC, the first radio to broadcast their music in the States. After that, they checked in at the Shoreham Hotel, having reserved the entire 7th floor to avoid fans. At 8:31 p.m., the Fab Four stepped onto the stage of the Washington Coliseum, a boxing arena, for their first live concert in North America. Their appearance, lasting 30 minutes, consisted in a performance of Roll Over Beethoven, From Me to You, I Saw Her Standing There, This Boy, All My Loving, I Want to Be Your Man, Please Please Me, Till There Was You, She Loves You, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Twist and Shout, and Long Tall Sally. With manager Brian Epstein's consent, the gig was shot by CBS and shown, with other music-related footage, in cinemas across the USA on the 14th and 15th of March, with two matinee screenings for each day. The footage omitted Long Tall Sally, but did a good job capturing the excitement of the event, the Beatles, and the problematic stage they were given. Ringo's drums weren't mounted correctly, George's microphone didn't work, and had to be substituted with a mic that had its own problems. Roddy Myles-Evans had to turn Starr's revolving drum kit twice so that the band could relocate and face the audience behind their back and on their side, and so on. In addition to these technical problems, the band was under fire. The fans had read on a newspaper that the Beatles liked jelly beans and proceeded throwing thousands of jelly beans on stage throughout the performance. Talking about being obnoxious, right? You'll find a playlist of YouTube videos from that concert in the episode description. After the gig, the Beatles had to attend a reception at the British Embassy. After being touched and pawed by pretty much everyone present as if they were some kind of animals to caress, they had enough and walked out in disgust after someone decided to cut a lock of Ringo's hair from behind his left ear. In 1965, Ringo Starr married Maureen Cox at the Caxton Hall Register office in London. John Lennon and George Harrison were among the guests, while Brian Epstein served as best man. Paul McCartney, being on holiday in Portugal, did not attend the ceremony. After the event, the newlyweds reached Hove in Sussex for their honeymoon. In 1967, John Lennon was at the Twickenham Film Studios to work on his contribution to the post-production of the How I Won the War film. While the Beatles' flixes had been hectic production affairs, the completion of this film took a much longer time. The shooting had been completed in November 1966, but the movie premiered only on the 18th of October 1967. In 1968, the Beatles were at the EMI studios between 4 p.m. and 2 a.m. to shoot a promotional clip for Lady Madonna. Instead of miming a performance of the song, though, they recorded 10 rhythm tracks and the overdubs for a new piece, Hey Bulldog, that they intended to submit to the Yellow Submarine soundtrack, instead of the unfinished You Know My Name, Look Up the Number. So, when the filming had ended and their work on Hey Bulldog had been committed to tape, they watched the raw film while the song was mixed in mono. The footage was later edited into two similar but different clips, distributed to British and American televisions by NEMS. In 1969, John Lennon and some unknown sound engineer produced mock stereo mixes of some of John and Yoko's avant-garde recordings at the EMI Studios in Abbey Road. It's not known exactly which recordings, and John took away both the new mixes and the old mono master tapes at the end of this 3 to 5:30 p.m. session. On this day in 1970, John Lennon and the Plastic Ono Band filmed their appearance on Top of the Pops to promote their new single, Instant Karma. The filming took place at the BBC's Television Centre between 7:30 and 10 p.m. after a 3:30 p.m. rehearsal. The band included John on electric piano, Klaus Voormann on bass, Alan White on drums, and Myles-Evans on tambourine, but the performance only produced John's new vocals, serving to complete the pre-recorded track from the 27th of January recording, edited for the occasion on the previous day, as detailed in episode 40 of What a Fab Day. The band filmed four clips, with the third and the fourth chosen to be aired on the following day on BBC One, between 7:15 and 8 p.m, and then on the 19th of February, same times. On the same day, at the EMI studios, a 2:30 to 11:45 p.m. session produced a complete version of I'm a Fool to Care for Ringo Starr's Sentimental Journey. The song, arranged by Klaus Voormann, featured a 15-piece orchestra, acoustic guitar, bass, drums, piano, and, naturally, vocals by Ringo. This concludes today's episode of What a Fab Day. Remember that the episode description includes the link to the 1964 Washington DC performance, as well as the usual link to the bibliography of the show, with its Amazon affiliate links. In addition, please remember to visit www.simonmas.com/support to find ways to help me out and support this podcast and my other music-related efforts, even without spending a penny. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.